Well, we're here to answer your gaming and game night questions.
Send your gaming and game night questions to questions@tabletopbellhop.com or head over to our website and click on Ask the Bellhop.
Or if you're here live, feel free to put them into the lobby or chat room here on Twitch.
Well, tonight's question comes from Perpetual Ploy. They ask, how do you handle board game nepotism? My group has three couples, so we are always looking for advice. They remind us that games break down if leaders aren't targeted. Not to let people sit by each other, removing the ability of couples to take two turns without others influencing the game. And including group and peer pressure to jeer at them for shady moves. Their personal board game motto is play to win. Every move you make should be better to your better your position, objective, or result, despite personal relationships. They say my spouse learned quickly that I don't pull punches in games.
Okay, so my first thought when Mo read me the question and said this is what we're going to be talking about this week, I'm like, this is a problem. It's never even occurred to me. Apparently, it never occurred to me to be extra nice or extra mean to Mo when we're playing. Or my kids. I don't pull punches with my kids either. I tell them that up front. I'm like, nope, you're in for a ride, guys.
Yep.
But that said, I have definitely seen it with other people, especially at our public play events. I will say our regular game group is pretty good about it. Though even with when we had our old Monday night group, now and then there'd be a few things where people would hold grudges from one game into the next, which is also a symptom of this, because honestly, this problem to me is not exclusive to couples. It could be friends, enemies, and basically any time something from outside the game influences a decision in the game. To me, that can be a problem. It's a potential problem. No. Like I've definitely played.
So I also want to point out a very human problem that can lead to this kind of behavior sometimes. And that is that people are really, really bad at being random. Just absolutely horrible at it. Like there is all sorts of science to support the fact that you are not able to be random. So either focusing on or avoiding people often feels like a better solution than picking on everyone in turn or trying to pick randomly. Often it feels like doing something to the person that you know best may even be the safest solution. After all, you can always make it up to them later rather than making a stranger feel awkward or risk antagonizing them. And a lot of us don't like to, make it feel like someone's going to be angry at us. We're trying to reduce conflict.
Okay, yeah. I never thought of that before, and now I'm going to be feeling paranoid about it next time I'm playing with strangers. I'm like, oh, wait.
So I don't know. Maybe it's just me, but it could just because I host a lot of public play events and I play with a lot more strangers than the two of you often do. But I have definitely seen this being a problem where two good friends will sit down at the table together playing. I'm going to use Catan as an example because it's one where this I've seen it happen the most often, where the couple at the table, friends, partners, whatever it happens to be, won't play the robber on each other because they don't want any bad feelings for later in the night, perhaps, or they don't want to seem like they don't want to, again, like you were saying, have bad conflict with someone they don't know, or favorable traits. Like I have definitely sat at a table where I'm like, had a couple there and go, I'll give you one rock and you give me three wheat and three rocks so I can build the city. And they're like, sure, here you go. And everyone else at the table is like, what are you doing? Like, what the heck? You just gave him a free city. Other examples in other games are when someone does have to attack a point later. It's like you can steal space. You can steal 2 points from any other player at the table, and they steal it from the player who's in dead last because it's their sister or their sibling or another personal person in their family.
Okay,
I've seen it where it goes the opposite way, where, okay, if you get a thing, you have to help someone else out. And instead of helping, you know, the person who's in last or the person who's doing badly or the person that could use the help the most, they give the point leader even more points and increase the spread because they want to be nice to the person at the table.
Okay, I got into this argument earlier with you when we first started talking about this. I feel like, yes, okay, it's not good if they're doing it because they're trying to be extra nice to someone at the table. But I will say sometimes people are not necessarily aware of who the point leader is. Yep. Not everyone is always cognizant of that, and getting mad at them for it isn't always fair.
No, I agree. It's more when it's a big obvious. I'm not saying you have to be counting all the cards or that you have to always attack the point leader and you have to know who the point leader is. But it's often very obvious when there is someone who is not doing well. And it's also possible that personal feelings are getting in the way, and people target other people for reasons that have nothing to do with the game that's going on. I've definitely played a game where everyone targeted one person because they didn't like them, or they did like them and they're joshing with them and everyone thought it was funny to beat up on that one person. Now, the other thing I did want to point out is that this isn't always a bad thing. In some games, it's perfectly acceptable. I've played many games, especially Take That games, party games, games like Munchkin, any of those games that are Take That, where your entire goal is to screw over other players. It's perfectly acceptable to screw over another player for an outside the game reason or because it's funny. Munchkin, Hex, Lifeboats, Cashing Guns, Survive, Get Bit. Even some lighter Euros like Downfall of Pompeii. I know our kids love throwing each other's little cylinder people into the volcano.
You see, one of the times I was thinking about this at a public play event, and times I've seen this play out in either the positive or the negative event, are games like Monstrosity, where you don't necessarily vote for the person who has the best drawing because they're your partner. Or you are voting for your partner despite the fact that their drawing doesn't actually look like anything like the things. You know, I have seen more often than not in those drawing games. Because again, the voting, when you're voting, it can get awkward.
So how about when everyone always decides to pick on me from round one because they've decided mom always wins?
Well, that's
because you always win. I think that can be a problem, really. I think that can be an issue, though. What I would say is it's the start of the game and no one has the lead, I'm probably going to go against the person I think is going to win either way. That's where I think it is fair to target the player you know who is better at the game than you to give you that early advantage. But if there's an advantage to attack someone else, I think you're better off doing that. I'm saying attack. And Sean brought up another point that's important too, is I've also seen it go the other way, right? I've seen it flipped where people I don't know if it's to avoid the feeling of favoritism, they don't want it to feel like nepotism, so they personally attack their significant other or their friend or their sibling or the person at the table they know the most, where the one player will go out of their way to be overly mean to that one player to go, look, I'm being fair. Look, just because we're siblings doesn't mean we're going to work together. And I've seen that almost, not necessarily ruin a game, but kind of ruin the fun for everyone else.
Because that's not only that, there's that, and some of it is definitely, I have definitely seen, you know, I'm not playing favorites. Look how I'm attacking that person who you think I would be friends. But it's also a matter of, I know that I can, again, it's that I can be angry with them and we can deal with it later. Whereas I don't know you. The avoiding of conflict is a big thing. Mm-hmm. We've already had someone in the chat room say, absolutely safer to play cooperative games than to get into arguments. There are a lot of people in the gaming space who don't want that level of conflict are against it, perhaps for personal reasons, for historical reasons, for whatever reasons. They aren't comfortable in there is conflict in this game. It is part of the game. Right. And then when the game is over, that conflict is no longer.
See, in that case, to me, I just don't play those games, right? So our comment in the chat is actually, they prefer to play cooperative games so that they don't get into arguments. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is the proper answer for that one, is if you know it's a game where you're playing Take That and you don't like stabbing strangers in the back, don't play Take That games with strangers. Save them for at home with your personal group that you're used to playing with, or your personal family. And I think that's just knowing your expectations when you sit down to play. And I think the group in the chat room in particular knows that that's how what their group enjoys and what they don't. I think you do have to watch for that.
Yeah, I prefer not to play co-ops for the reverse reason, because co-ops will lead to arguments.
Whereas I've
seen that too.
I don't actually mind playing conflict with strangers as much, because I don't feel guilty attacking someone I don't know, because it isn't personal. I have no idea who this person is. Whereas sitting around with friends and family, I might feel more guilty and more hesitant to attack people for, especially when there isn't a game leader. That's one of the biggest problems, is when everyone is more or less equal and you've got that card where it's like, well, I have to attack someone. Who the heck do I attack? Everyone is at the same place. No one has that lead that I need to take away from them. Where do I go? And again, that's where that whole randomness comes in. I could just pick someone at random, but it's not going to be random. There's going to be something behind it.
And honestly, that's where I don't think it's a problem. Like, that's where, if there's no other mitigating factor, attack whoever you want for whatever reason you want, right? Mm-hmm. But whether it's, you know, something that happened in a game last week, whether it's you want some brownie points for later that night, whoever, you know, help pay for the pizza, whatever you want. In that case, when everyone's about even, I think that's where it doesn't actually matter and it's not a problem. And again, I still think certain games are designed for it, and it fits. Cashing guns, pointing the gun at your siblings or whatever. Well, that sounds terrible. But pointing the foam gun that's very clearly a toy at your parents. Kids love to attack the parents while playing games. It is part of the fun of the game.
They got into some really specific details in the question, like not sitting couples side by each so that they wouldn't play one turn after the other. I would have never gotten to that level of thinking this out.
Yeah, I've never seen it become that much of a problem where I felt the need to split people up. But I will say, I have played games where we split up the couples. Like, if you're playing teams, I like to split the couples. Well, it totally depends on the game, but most games, if you're playing like a strategy game, right? Something where a point leader, a point salad, a euro, in general, I'd rather split the family members. Now, party game, it goes both ways, right? Like, well, sometimes it's fun to play couple versus couple. Other times it's fun to mix up the group. So you play, you know, whatever, girls versus the boys or whatever else, however else you want to split it, adults versus the kids. Mm-hmm. So again, I think it's perfectly acceptable in the right game. And I think what a lot of this boils down to, And we've kind of thrown a couple in here, but I want to move on to tips for dealing with this if it is a problem. So step one, is it a problem? Figure it out. Like, if your group is perfectly cool with this and that's part of the group dynamic, there's nothing wrong with that. We're not telling you you can't attack your sibling or you can't play favorites with your wife, as long as everyone expects that at the table and everyone's okay with it. And this is something we've talked about many times on the show before, and that is the social contract of sitting down to play a board game. Now, I know when I say that, a bunch of people are like, ooh, contracts, what are you talking about? These are supposed to be games, supposed to be fun. But whether you realize it or not, when you sit down to play a game, you are taking part in a social contract. It's an unwritten one, and that contract depends on the nature of the game. And again, playing favorites is part of some games. Many party games mm-hmm. are like that. But then other ones, you generally, when you sit down to play a strategy game, something where you're adding up points and there's going to be a definite winner, that contract tends to be, when it's your turn, you're going to play to try to win, even if winning isn't that important. Like, we're not talking about playing for money. If we want to talk about tournament play, that is completely different beast, where, yes, everyone should be playing to win, and everything they do should make it so that they get closer to winning the game with every action they take. But I think if you're sitting down, especially with strangers at a public play game night, like, say, our last one at the Walkerville Brewery, and you're about to sit down and play Sushi Boat, the assumption is you're going to play to win. And you're not going to do something like, I'm going to tip this waitress to move the sushi so you can get it, so that you do better. Thank you, honey. Right? You don't want that to happen in that kind of game, unless, again, you set that expectation ahead of time.
Okay, I take back everything I said previously. If someone did that in a tournament, I would be livid.
See? There you go.
Yeah, again, tournaments are definitely a different beast. I think for the most part, this question and this discussion is involving, friendly play, game nights out, regular family game nights. I think we can probably assume that this isn't, you know, full on tournament play, although it could be a very right. competitive group. You never know.
And it totally depends. Again, this is the same thing we talk about all the dang time, right? It's get everyone on the same page. It's session zero. It's setting expectations. It's you sit down and sit down to play the game. And if you are a couple, you can even tell people, you're like, look, Deanna and I, we're together, but trust me, we're not going to play favorites here. If I'm attacking Deanna, it's because I think she's going to win the game. And if she's attacking me, she thinks I'm getting close to overtaking her score. And you can explain that. Or you can sit down and go, you know what? We like to play favorites. We hold grudges. We play this game as cutthroat as possible. And that's perfectly fine if everyone agrees to it.
I do hold grudges. I might be attacking you because you told everyone that I'm going to win the game.
There you go. Now, the things you're expected to do, right, we talked about this, is target the current leader or someone you expect to take the lead. Because some people are like, you got to target the leader. And I'm like, yeah, I could target the leader, but I know D has a handful of, whatever over there, or I know Sean's almost completed a full set that's going to give him the lead. And while it looks like Dave's winning, I know Sean's actually way closer than it looks like. So I'm going to attack Sean. One of the things you can do is talk about it. Now, this is totally, again, a group thing and who you're playing with, whether they're open to table talk. And I know Deanna hates it when people point that out. But if someone does like kind of give you a weird look because you're attacking a sibling or a friend or looking like you're paying favorites, you can explain, well, I'm attacking them because, look, I'm going to go up by 3 points, where if I attack Sean, I'm only going to go up by 2. And overall, it's a 6-point spread.
I don't like when you start using Jedi mind tricks to try and encourage other people to make certain moves at the table. I know what you do. So that's a different complaint.
That's not really favoritism whatsoever. I just suggest moves to other players that are valid for them to take. That's all it is.
Yes.
Sometimes valid, those moves unfortunately, help me too.
Valid does not mean good, but valid. One of the things I think is there's definitely a benefit to, especially at a public play event, and especially at an event like Walkerville, I think was a great example, where if we as experienced players are sitting down with some newer gamers or some, you know, first time gamers or whatever, explaining some of our reasoning for doing things, if we are in a take that situation, is actually a really great way to not only, you know, lessen any tension, but also help them learn to play the game better. And help them be better gamers.
If it does become an actual problem. So what do you do if this happens, right? You're sitting at a table and you see it happen. Try to be adults, try to talk about it, right? If you failed to set the expectations ahead of time, just be like, excuse me, like, why are you helping them out? Because that move doesn't make any sense in the game we're currently playing. You'd have a better advantage helping everyone else. I'm just wondering why you would make that move. And maybe they'll point out something like, well, because next turn I'm going to play this card, which means I get to steal all those resources back to go back to Catan and the evil Monopoly card. So maybe that's what it is. Or maybe they don't realize they're doing it. Again, like Sean was saying about the randomness and the whole fear of affecting strangers, right? The conflict aversion. Maybe that's why they're doing it. But like the whole thing is, you're not sitting down, again, unless you're in a tournament where you're not allowed to talk to each other. There's no sacred bond here, right? You're just sitting here. You're all trying to play a game together and all have fun together. And maybe they don't realize that it's ruining the fun of other players and bring it up. Like, I know it's hard, right? As someone who also has some social anxiety issues, it's not always easy to do, but bring it up.
I think that would make me really uncomfortable. Particularly, like, I'm playing a strategic game, I'm probably thinking 2, 3, 4 turns ahead, and I probably did something because I'm planning something further along. And if you ask me, then I have to reveal to you that I have this card or I'm going to do this thing.
You could just say, I've got plans. This.
Yeah, I think I have plans is potential.
Is probably valid, yeah. And it's totally different if you're playing with new people. You're teaching people, that's different. But I mean, like, if you're playing a competitive game, I don't know. I think that would make me uncomfortable.
I can see issues where there's a couple who has, you know, game night all the time together, and they're and all of a sudden they're out at a public event and they have between themselves unspoken agreements about how things go. Maybe they are brutal with each other, and seeing that behavior transitioned into a public play event or a new game group could certainly be uncomfortable for other people. And that's where everyone needs to sort of stop and say, look, what's going on here? Is this normal? Are we okay here? Right. That person's going to win now because you two are slashing and burning each other's fields. You know, there's definitely times where a couple who has their own dynamic introduced into a new environment could get things awkward.
And Kat and Tori used to like pretend like their table talk would be extra mean towards each other because they thought it was comic, right? Something they would frequently do when we were playing with them all the time. I don't think they really tipped the game, but they would trash talk each other a lot.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And the amount of trash talk at a table, again, that's a very group dependent thing. That's something if you like to trash talk and you go to a public play event, maybe hold back a bit. To see what the feelings are at the rest of the table, or just again, come right out front and say it. Say, hey, at our tables, we like to trash talk. Everyone good with trash talk? There's no problem asking for consent at the tabletop game table. That is not a bad thing. It is a good thing. I wish more people were comfortable with. I've definitely sat down at a table where people are like, we like to trash talk. Is that cool? And I'm like, yeah, sure, go for it. Or, you know what? No, we don't really know each other. And it might be hard to differentiate what's serious and what's not. And if I actually hurt anyone's feelings for this game, at least, can we keep it on the down low? And maybe if we play a second round, we can get more into it.
But I remember with Kat and Tori, like, they would sound like they were being mean to each other sometimes, to the point that we took the kids aside that were sometimes listening to us play and say, okay, guys, they're joking. That's not a normal relationship, okay? So I could see if you had people come out and do that in a public play and you didn't know them, you might be like, the heck are they doing over there? That's, you know.
Absolutely. And to be fair, again, because we're all different, we all have different things, and sometimes we just aren't the people who can confront someone else on an issue. Not all game nights work. Not all game nights go well. There are failures. And if you want to check out episode number 78, They Can't All Be Great, we discuss on what things to do when we have those game nights that just don't go the way you expect.
Definitely happens.
Yeah, part of that, we actually talk about potential player problems. We talk about RPGs as well as board games, what to do if the game is failing with everyone at the table, and so on. So, yeah, if you're looking for details on how to have these conversations, what to talk about, that is a great place to look. And then there's also an article on game night failures over on the blog, which I'll throw a link to in our show notes.
So other than that, in our chat room, we've had a few people talking. Again, we had Charlie Brown saying, you know, 100% agree with you. Safer to play cooperative games than to get into arguments. Whereas Trasharama says, I'm fine with conflict if the rules are well defined. Mm-hmm. Where conflict is defining the rules themselves, they don't like, which is games like Magic the Gathering. Mm-hmm. And then Roger Dodger says, I've seen some feelings get hurt in a game, but their group bounces back pretty fast. And that's a good thing to know about your game group, is whether or not they are able to recover quickly, or if there could be grudges and hard feelings if something isn't done or something isn't said.
Yeah, I got to say, the Magic the Gathering, I'm perfectly fine with until it goes out of the game stuff, like people cheating and yelling at other players and flipping mm-hmm. tables and screaming, and when the game's done being bad sports, which is not really the playing favorites thing. Now, I don't know some of the other Magic variants, when you're playing multiplayer, if there's a way to help out other players that would fit this topic a little better. But yeah, part of the overly competitive gamers can be a problem. But as I've suggested many times, when you're talking public play events, if you can sit them all at the same table, and they'll have a ton of fun with each other.
Yeah. Charlie Brown mentions, I enjoy competitive play in public venues, even with Deanna, because you know she's playing to win. Cosmic Encounters solves this problem, as you are told who to attack. That's actually, there's a few games like that out there, which are fantastic options for that problem, where, you know, you're only ever attacking to the left, or you're only ever attacking who the dice tell you to attack. Mm-hmm. More of those would actually be a good thing, I think.
One of the games we're reviewing tonight has that, when you play with three or more players.
Mm-hmm.
I like the way that game does it, because it's got a, you roll to see who to attack, but two of the options are your opponents choose or you choose. So I like that a little better than Cosmic Encounter.
Well, and there's the group play, I want to say is it Emperor in the Star Realms, the new Star Realms format, where it's you can't attack the Emperor
only the players on the sides. Mm-hmm.
Charlie Brown says they did lose a player due to trash talking, and they never thought to define it until something bad happened. And unfortunately, that's often the case, that it takes something negative to bring it all up and make people understand.
We know it's hard to do, but if you are uncomfortable during a game, if you can stop the game, say, can we please stop, point out what you didn't like, say, hey, we can keep playing, but please, you know, I don't appreciate the trash talk. Can we tone that down a bit? That's all you got to say. Mm-hmm. I know very few gamers who are going to take the attitude of, well, no, that's part of the fun. They're going to be like, oh, sorry. Like, it's not intentional in most cases.
Yep.
People aren't trying to make it not fun for other people.
Yeah. And a lot of times, again, it goes back to that, what you know. If, you know, it's those people who do that all the time in their own home games and are suddenly mm-hmm. in a different situation, and they don't know to stop because they've never had to before, or it's just come so naturally to them that they need to, you know, bite their tongue a little more often, and people need to remind them to do that sometimes.
Alrighty. Thank you, chat room, for all the additional comments. That's it for our discussion on playing favorites at the board game table, how to avoid it, as well as realizing that it can be perfectly fine depending on the group. It's just all about setting expectations ahead of time. Have you experienced board game nepotism at your table? Share your horror stories in the comments.
Or better yet, jump on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com and share your stories there.